to have invited me here for this session. It's very nice to be in Chandigarh, one of the best cities in the country. Nice to be here. And thanks, Kriti, for the nice intro. And okay, I'm going to talk about the digital initiatives in higher education. If you look at the impact of digital initiatives, probably it is least in the case of education. Unfortunately, if you look at, if you compare with the other sectors, but right now probably we are in the stage of a bit of transformation on that. Because if you consider the impact in the other sectors, here the impact so far has been very less, but a number of initiatives have been launched. Hopefully we should get the result of this in the days to come. So during my session, what I am going to talk about is that I'm going to talk about some of the key digital initiatives. They include, a mention was made by Mr. Patnaik, Dr. Patnaik in a session about the Swayam. I'm going to talk about Swayam. I'm going to talk about Swayam Prabha, National Digital Library, E-Yantra, then National Academic Depository, then Virtual Labs, FOSI, Campus Connectivity, and Operational Digital Board. These are the few projects I'm going to tell you about. What are they, briefly about that. Now, before I venture into that, why at all digital education? Why do digital initiatives are required? See, if you just compare India with the other countries, the gross enrollment ratio in the higher education, we stand at 25%. Whereas look at the average in the other countries where they are. They are much higher. USA it is as high as 84%. Russia it is 71%. And even in the developing countries, the world average is 36.5. But we are way back in 25. In fact, we call ourselves a software power and all that. But in the ICT development index, we rank 137 out of 167 countries. Where are we? Our Indians dominate Microsoft, Indians dominate Google, Indians dominate whatnot, that software company you can talk of. But what is it, the reality in India itself? We are nowhere. Now, why digital education? After the 70 years of independence, you know the competing demands on the resources. We want excellent education. But we want equal access, means that everybody should have access to best education. That's what is the idea. The gross enrollment ratio right now is 25. We want to move it up to 30 by 2020. That is the target that we have set upon ourselves. To do that, in the brick and mortar model, if you are for the next 20 years, every month you have to create 6 universities and 270 colleges. Then only you can do that. Is it possible? If you want to go to even GER of 30, which is still below the world average, you got to create 6 universities and 270 colleges every month. Then probably you can achieve that rate. So this is not a feasible solution. That is the need why you need a digital education. Okay? The technology gives you the balance to achieve both excellence and equal access. So the digital education is more becoming a must than an option. Without that, you just can't survive now. Well, Kriti was talking about, I believe there are three devices which has influenced our life the most. One obviously is the mobile phone, isn't it? One probably can live without the spouse, but not without the mobile phone, isn't it? We keep it under the pillow also when we sleep, I say, isn't it? We don't leave it then also. What to talk of? Second is the internet, third is the television. These are the three devices which has changed our life and changing our life continuously. That is technology. Now, see, everything has got a time for itself. I remember one of my friends about 30-35 years back invested in a company making tissue paper. He came from abroad and invested in that company. That company went broke. There was no market for that at that time. Today, everybody uses tissue paper, isn't it? Without tissue, well, we just is part of our daily life. So similarly, what was not possible some time back could be possible now, because the ecosystem is changing. The ecosystem around us is changing. That's the reason for that. See, the millennials by 2020, if you look that, 36% of the population will be there. 61% are internet users. 78% are online shoppers. The internet penetration is very high. There are 60 crore smartphones. There are 50 crore internet users. So this is why when we say that, अरे हमने पहले भी try किया था, हुआ नहीं है. वो answer नहीं है. पहले नहीं हुआ, अब होगा. Isn't it? How many of you were banking, doing, online banking 10 years back? Probably hardly anybody. Today, it will be almost everybody. Isn't it? Even if there is a bank strike, we are not bothered now. Otherwise, bank strike used to be a big heading in the newspapers. So this is what the ecosystem is changing. Now, the very important thing is, you know, lifelong learning. See, earlier it was, learn, पहले पढ़ाई करते हैं, then earn, कुछ पैसा कमाएंगे, फिर retire. And now that is not there. It is continuous learning. Even after retirement today also, if I don't keep on learning, I will become redundant even in my house. That is sure. That is for sure. Forget about job ka. So this is the context today. It is a lifelong learning. I think yesterday or day before yesterday, you had a picture in the newspaper of a 78-year-old person registering for a PhD. Right? I think it was there in the newspapers. What to talk of that, I completed my LLB only last year. So it is good to learn. It's a lifelong learning has become the norm now. The future of the work demands that. Okay? Now, let me now come. No, I was just contextualizing it. Because why the digital education is required and why it can happen now, because the ecosystem is changing, that's the way we are living. Now let me go to some of the important projects in that. Swayam, that is the online education system of the, which has been put in place by the Government of India, Ministry of Human Resource Development. I am associated with this project. All these projects I am associated with, what I am talking now. The objective of this project is anyone, anywhere, anytime learning. The learning at no cost. Then equity in the access to quality education. I will come on each one of them. Don't worry, I'm just running through that. This project was launched formally on 9th of July 2017 by the Honorable President of India. There are courses, there are nine national coordinators. I'll come to that next. And the other part also, there is a credit transfer mechanism also in place. Let me come to that in the next slide. Anyway, we have about, right now we have more than 1500 courses running in that. And we have not 21 lakhs, it is another 15 has to be added. That's about 37 lakhs are people are there in that. Now, through this, what we are doing? See, earlier it's not a simple video. Online education is not simple video. We are mimicking the classroom here. See, there are four quadrants in the whole thing. When I'm mentioning means, first quadrant is the high quality video lectures will be there. That is the person who is the teaching, the lectures will be there. Second is self-instructional material, ebook, downloadable ebook and the extra reading material. Third is a discussion forum. Means you can raise questions, they will be answered. You can raise the doubts, or between the peers you can discuss. This is available. This is a platform. Swayam is a platform. It's a software platform. And assignments, you can submit the assignments, and they will be corrected and sent back to you. See, this is what, and there will be an end examination. Now, in this semester, that is July 2018 semester, there are about 470 courses which has been offered, for which the exams will be conducted in November end. So what I am trying to say, that this is a system, this is a portal which is trying to mimic the classroom. It's not simply videos. As if you are, whatever happens in the classroom, we are trying to make it happen here. The advantage is that these courses are delivered by the best teachers in the country. For example, all the technical courses are delivered by the professors in the IITs, all the engineering courses. Yeah, these are our national, 8 national coordinators. I was mentioning about that. UGC is the national coordinator for all the postgraduate degree courses. Then technical courses, it is the NPTEL. The engineering people maybe will be familiar with NPTEL systems, right? How many of you are familiar with NPTEL? Yeah, there are quite a number. Yeah, they are running for the last few years, right? So NPTEL courses are done by the IIT Madras. Is this thing, other IITs contribute to that. Then the consortium of educational communication, they do for the undergraduate programs. Indira Gandhi Open University for diplomas and certificates, and NCRT for school education programs, and NAOS for the children education program. In fact, the National Institute of Open Schooling, NAOS, recently we are running a program of BA for the elementary teachers. 14 lakh teachers are being trained through this. 14 lakh teachers across the country are being trained through this. The program is running, 1 year is over, because there is a Supreme Court order that these 14 lakh teachers have to be trained in 2 years. So this is the only way we could do that. Successfully we are training them through this. Now IIM Bangalore, they are putting up a lot of management courses. They are very popular courses, I can tell you that. The management courses. Then NITER. Even NITER Chandigarh has put up a course on that. One course is by NITER Chandigarh in that. I mean, that's what probably, I mean, Dr. Patnaik was mentioning. They are doing it for teacher education. These are our 8 national coordinators who put up the courses. Now, there are a number of online education platforms across the world. You might have heard about Coursera, then edX and all that. What is so different than the Indian platform? This is an indigenously developed platform which the government of India has got it developed in India. The difference is that, you know, it is blended with the conventional education, means it is integrated. UGC and AICT has brought about a regulation saying that up to 20% of the courses you can take it through online, which will be covered, which can be part of your regular program. Say I am part of, let us say, Punjab University, and Punjab University has approved this, means 20% of the courses I can take it through this, and still it will be part of my mark list, and I can get the credit for that. This is a unique feature in the Indian system, Indian platform. And today, as on today, 106 universities have already approved it. So slowly, slowly, the other university senates are also approving it. So up to 20% can clear the online course. It shall be awarded credits which can be part of their university degree, right? 20% is possible. Second is that the same UGC and AICT have come up with a regulation saying that any teacher offering a course through Swayam will get the same credit as if they are offering it in the classroom. Also, if they undergo a course for their career advancement program, they get points for that. So this, the unique feature, again I am repeating, is that this is blended with our formal method of education. How can you benefit from Swayam? Well, see, there are 3 classes of learners here normally. Somebody who takes the course just for learning, it doesn't need a certificate or anything. The second category are the people who go through the course, they would like to have a certificate also. Third are the students who are studying in a university or a college. In a college, they want to take this course because it could be possible that in that particular college, that for that particular elective or subject, a teacher is not there. But the student would like to take that course. How would he take that course? He can always take an online course and take the credit for that. Because the way it can be used is that the best way to use is this in the blended mode. Because even if there is a teacher in the college, the teacher can use this course. See, it is actually speaking, the role of the teacher is changing. I don't know how many of you will accept that. In fact, last Friday, we had a session to promote this in Hyderabad, and there were 600 teachers and principals from Tamil Nadu, Andhra, Telangana, and Pondicherry in Hyderabad, attending that. See, the role of the teacher is raising, so my role there was to talk to them and, help them to adopt this. Earlier was that the teacher used to teach everything, but here, now the thing is, in many cases, the students may be knowing more than the teacher, because they have access to so much of information. Let us accept it. The role of the teacher is changing, because he is not only teaching, the facilitator now. He will be a facilitator. The teacher becomes a facilitator. The teacher need not feel bad that if the student asks me something I don't know about it, then what a teacher I am. No.